In this video, we'll build a cash flow statement from scratch using an income statement and a balance sheet. And this is one of the most common interview questions in finance or accounting. So let's get into it. To build a cash flow statement, we're going to need a balance sheet for the current year as well as the previous year, which is what we have right over here. And also we're gonna need an income statement for the period between those 2 years. That's the information we have over here for a sportswear company, and you can download the Excel file in the description. As you can see under the balance sheet, if you go all the way down by pressing Control down arrow, you'll find that under the check, which basically checks if everything is balancing, you'll notice that under the 2021 figures, there's actually, it's not zero. So that means that the total assets and the total liabilities and shareholders' equity don't match. And that's because of the cash flow over here, which we currently don't have, and we're going to derive based on the cash flow statement that we'll create right next to it. To give you a bit of background on the cash flow statement, there's three main sections: the cash flow from operating activities, cash flow from investing activities, and lastly, cash flow from financing activities. And after summing these three, you're going to get the change in cash. We'll start with the operating section, which has to do with cash inflows and outflows from the core business activity. So that might be from buying inventory, collecting bills from customers, etc. Hopping onto Excel, over here to the right-hand side, we're gonna create the cash flow statement. So firstly, let's select this area over here, Control-C, just to copy and paste that formatting, Control-V there. And then here, we're just gonna type the cash flow statement. There you go. And now there's two different ways to calculate the cash flow from operating activities: the direct method and the indirect method. The direct method only uses cash transactions and ignores all non-cash transactions to reach net income. While on the other hand, for the indirect method, it starts with net income and eventually reaches the same net cash flow from operating activities, but it still accounts for non-cash transactions like depreciation. Overall, the indirect method is more popular as most businesses operate using accrual accounting. And you might wonder, what does that mean? It means that they record their revenues or expenses when a transaction occurs, as opposed to when the cash is actually received or dispensed. For example, suppose you delivered an iPhone to a customer, but you're only getting paid in 30 days time. Under accrual accounting, that would be accounted for as you earned that revenue already, but under cash basis accounting, it wouldn't, because you haven't received the cash up until 30 days later when you do. So using the indirect method, firstly, we're gonna have net income under a cash flow statement. So let's go ahead and link that, which is just gonna be under the income statement right over here. And we can copy and paste that for the figure as well. And then just after that, you are going to have depreciation and amortization, which is added back. So we'll go ahead and select it, which should be right over here. And we'll just copy and paste that as well. The reason it's added back is because it's a non-cash expense. So that means that there's no actual cash inflow or outflow that occurred. As an example, if you think about equipment in a factory that's appreciating in value, nobody's actually paying cash as the value is being written down. And since the cash flow statement is all about tracking cash, we want to remove the depreciation expense, and so that's why we add it back to reverse its effect. Next up on the cash flow statement, we have changes in working capital. And this is simply the difference between current assets other than cash minus current liabilities. Let's start with the current asset side. So for this, you can just go to equals and we're gonna make this dynamic, put a quotation and put change in, press the space there, close the quotations and then do the ampersand. We're gonna link that one to accounts receivables. And now when we drag this down all the way to other current assets, you can see that it dynamically updates. And for the figures, we're gonna take the difference. So it's gonna be the 2021 figure minus the accounts receivables in 2020, hit enter there. The reason we actually need to calculate the difference there, as opposed to just linking it like we did for the income statement line items, is because the balance sheet is for a snapshot of time. And so that's why we need the two different snapshots to find the difference. While on the income statement, it's just for a period of time, so it's accounting for that whole time range. When we think of the number under change in accounts receivables, if we look over to the balance sheet, you'll find that it's actually going up, which in terms of cash is not a good thing, because if the accounts receivable are going up, that means more and more people owe us money and they haven't actually paid us cash for it. So for this, we're gonna have to change the sign here. So press the F2 key and just at the very front, we're gonna go minus and then open the brackets and close them at the very end and hit enter. And same thing for the two above, they're just gonna follow the exact same pattern. In the case of inventory, for instance, as you can see, inventory went down, which essentially means that, hey, we had a lot of, say, shoes in our factory and we managed to sell them, and so that's cash coming in for us. Now looking at the current liability side, firstly, we can just copy and paste this formula and then press the F2 key, and we're just gonna drag that down all the way to current liabilities under short-term debt, which is gonna be the first line item there, and hit enter. But this time around for the formula, it's actually gonna be flipped. So we'll go over here, we'll go equals, and firstly we'll select the short-term debt of 2021 minus the short-term debt of 2020. And it says that it's a negative 224. And when you think about it intuitively, if the short-term debt has gone down, that means you paid cash to reduce that amount of debt. And so that's why it's negative, because it's a cash outflow. So that makes sense. The same logic applies to the other line items, but we're actually gonna go copy and control V there. And we're gonna skip the current portion of long-term debt, as we'll work on it later with the long-term debt that we have just below. So let's go ahead and drag that down to accounts payable. And same thing over here, we're gonna go equals. And firstly, we'll select the accounts payable of 2021 minus the accounts payable of 2020. Hit enter there, and then we can just drag those down all the way to the very bottom, which the last one is changing other current liabilities. Now that we worked out the working capital, we can go ahead and sum all of these, and this is gonna be the cash flow from operating activities. And over here, we're just gonna go equals, sum, press the tab key, and we'll select all of these over here and hit enter. While we're looking at just one technical interview question here, if you're looking to break into the financial services industry, the investment banking interview skills course will walk you through what to expect in the interview process, how you can tackle some of the toughest questions, and more. The course first explains what an investment banker does in their day-to-day, followed by the recruitment process, where you'll learn to answer all types of questions, ranging from behavioral or fit questions to technical questions on accounting and finance, and even brain teasers. Plus, the course features a recorded example of a successful interview, so you can see what to expect and how to navigate the questions successfully. So if you want to ace your interview, get 25% off using code KENJI25, and the link is going to be in the description. Alright, back to the cash flow statement. Moving on to the investing activities, and these include investing in property, plant, and equipment, buying stocks and bonds, etc. First, let's look at PP&E. So for that, we're just gonna type over here, purchase of PPE. And as you can see over here, we've got the gross property, plant and equipment all the way to the net down below. And for this, we're just gonna take equals the 2021 figure minus the 2020 figure. And again, we're gonna press the F2 key. We're gonna put a minus sign in front, and we're gonna open up those brackets and close them over here like so. Now, the reason we took the gross PPE over here as opposed to the net PPE is because of accumulated depreciation. And as you can see up over here, we already accounted for depreciation. And so that's why we're going for gross PPE up over here. Let's apply the same logic to the other line items under investing activities. So firstly, we're gonna have the purchase of other long-term investments. And just below that, we're gonna have other assets. And for these, the formula is gonna be pretty much the same. Press the F2 key there, because we're gonna have to drag it down. First one is gonna be other long-term investments. So let's go ahead and select that. And for other assets, we can just copy and paste that down. And then the sum of that is gonna be the cash flow from investing activities. And we're just gonna press the Alt equals, and that's gonna sum it for us. Moving on to financing activities, and this shows how a company funds its operations. And it's typically either in the form of debt or in the form of equity. In this case, if we look under non-current liabilities, you can see that we've got long-term debt and other liabilities as well. So let's go ahead and account for those. For long-term debt, it's increasing, so we'll go increase in long-term debt, press the tab key, and we're gonna do equals, open up the brackets there, and we're gonna select the 2021 figure minus the 2020 figure just next to it, close those brackets, and put a plus sign. And the reason we're doing a plus sign is because we also got to account for the current portion of long-term debt, which we didn't account for earlier. So we'll open up the brackets again, select this one minus this other one, close those brackets and hit enter. And when we think of this intuitively, if long-term debt has increased, that means that we actually got more cash. And so we owe more money, but we got cash in. And so that's why it's a positive sign there. For other liabilities, it's also an increase. So we'll go increase in other liabilities, press the tab key, and that's just gonna be equals to this one minus this one, and it's a lot simpler there. Hit enter, and from there we can start working on the equity side just below. Firstly, we can see over here that common equity has increased by quite a bit, so we're gonna put proceeds from share issuance, press the tab key equals, so that's gonna be this one minus this one over here, and hit enter. Basically, to explain what happened here, they issued more shares, so that means that in exchange for those shares, they got more cash into the company, and so that's the cash flow that went up. Then for the line item right below, which is actually the other comprehensive income or loss, we're not gonna account for it as it's an unrealized gain or loss. A simple example of this concept is, suppose you bought a house for 1 million and now it's worth 2 million. So that house has appreciated in value, but because you haven't actually sold it, there's no cash inflow for you. And so that's why we don't account for it in the cash flow statement. Lastly, we've got retained earnings that you can find down over here, and we're not gonna account for this one either, as part of the formula here includes net income, which we already accounted for at the very beginning of the cash flow statement. And here's the formula for retained earnings. It's the previous year's retained earnings plus any net income minus any dividends. Now, the dividends part of the formula we do need to account for, as that's a cash outflow in that the company is giving money to its investors, and so the cash is going out. Typically, you'll find dividends in a company's statement of shareholders' equity. However, if you're not given that in an interview, so if you only have the balance sheet and the income statement, then it's reasonable for you to assume that there's no dividends involved. For simplicity, in our case, we just put it down over here, as you can find it just below the income statement. So let's go ahead and work on it. For this, it's gonna be dividends paid. And we're just gonna go ahead and link it, which is gonna be this figure over here. And actually, it's gonna be a negative figure. Press the F2 key there and put a negative sign in front. From there, we can calculate the cash flow from financing activities. Press the tab key, press Alt equals, and that's gonna sum it up for us. Now, to get our ending cash balance, firstly, we need the beginning cash balance. So we'll type beginning cash balance, and that's simply going to be equals to, under the balance sheet, the 2020 cash balance, which is gonna be this first one over here. And then over here, you're gonna put the change in cash, which is simply going to be the sum of the cash flow from financing plus the cash flow from investing plus the cash flow from operating activities. Hit enter there. And then that's gonna be the ending cash balance. Just below that, press the tab key, and we're gonna go Alt equals again, hit enter. And now if we link this figure over here to the top of the balance sheet over here, everything should match, such that the check here should equal to zero. So let's go ahead and give that a try. We'll go equals and link that to the ending cash balance, hit enter there, and now it's all linked. So if you scroll all the way down to the bottom, you should see that the check is equaling to zero. If that's the case, that means that you did the process correctly. Let's now work on some formatting for the cash flow statement. So firstly, for all the values over here, we're gonna go Control Shift down arrow. Hopefully it'll get all the way to the bottom. From there, you're gonna press the Control 1 key, and under number, you can just go under number there again, hit this one, and then we want to use a separator, so hit the comma there. We don't want decimal places, so we'll put a zero and hit enter. That's looking slightly more like it. Then for the totals, let's go ahead and bolden them, so Control B. And we'll also put an top line border, so we'll go Alt H B P. Same thing with this one over here, so Control B, Alt HBP, and this very last one over here as well, Alt HBP. For the ending cash balance, let's put a bit more emphasis on it, so go Control B, and then we'll go Alt HBD, which is gonna give us the top and the bottom border, and let's also highlight it in yellow, so for that we'll go to Alt HH, and from there I'm just gonna go under my recent colors and select that yellow. Now if you go back to Control Up, all the way to the top, I think that's looking a lot more like it. For more on financial statements, check out this video over here on financial modeling, or this other link over here to learn more about finance and valuation. Smash that like and that subscribe button if you liked it, and I'll catch you in the next one.